Time-lapse is a beautiful way of showing time passing. Whether you are shooting sunrise, sunset, beach, mountains, clouds, or you are shooting people movement or cars over an intersection at night or during the day. And it's very easy to do with any of today's modern cameras, because all what you require is a bunch of photos that you combine them together and then transform them to a video. In today's video, I'm gonna show you my workflow in doing time-lapse. I use Lightroom in it and the Premiere Pro together. Stay tuned. What's up everyone, and welcome to my channel. If you are in a beautiful place where there is lots of movements around you, whether people, whether you are sitting on a beautiful beach, or in between mountains or in a forest, and you get inspired to capture the time movement of that place, here where time-lapse comes handy, and it can add big value for your footage. If you noticed also in the movies, they use time-lapse to show the time passing between night to day or day to night. So how you take time-lapse and how you deal with it. When it comes to time lapse, first thing you need to think about is how long your video should be. Do you want a video of 10 seconds, 15 seconds, between 7 to 10 seconds? That will be ideal and somehow light to the audience. Let's assume that you want to take a 10 seconds video. In order to take the 10 second video, you need to ask yourself the second question. What is your usual frame rates that you use in your videos? Example, for me, I use 24 frames per second. That means 24 photos per 1 second. If I want to shoot 10 seconds, I should have 240 photos so that I will be able to have a 10 seconds of time lapse. That's the basic calculation about it. But sometimes what happens that you shoot more photos, especially if you are doing, for example, day to night or night to day, where you will end up having over 600, 700 photos, sometimes 1,000-ish, sometimes 2,000. And then once you combine them all in post, you cut your video or speed it up even to reach to 10 seconds or 7 seconds. Depends on what is your final output that you want to show to your audience. Then you need to ask yourself how long you need to spend in taking your shots. Example, if you are shooting between sunrise and sunset, that might take 24 hours. But if you are shooting only the sunrise or only the sunset, which is approximately 2 hours, that means your interval or your time between every shot should be between like 3 to 5 seconds. But if you are shooting clouds and the clouds are moving very quickly, then you need your interval between 1 to 2 seconds. This is something you decide yourself based on the subject that you want to shoot. So once you decide your frames per second, how many frames you need per second, and you decide your timing and the interval timer, then you move to the equipment that required for the time lapse. The equipment you need in the time lapse, of course, your camera, whether it's a DSLR, mirrorless, or even smartphone that it shoots good raw photos. And then of course you need a tripod, and a solid tripod, not any tripod, because as much as the tripod heavy or as much as the tripod is steady, as much as you guarantee that you will have less shaky footage and less shaky in the image. So later on when you take the images and you start to work on it in post, all the images will be the same and no changes will be there in between. So that's very important to have a steady and a solid tripod. Also, sometimes when you are shooting in straight direct sun or in the direct sun that comes through the lens, you need ND filters as well to control the exposure and to control your shutter speed. Then you need a control over your camera. You can shoot AV, which is aperture priority, where you can set your aperture on a specific F number, like F16, F11, or F22 sometimes. And then the rest of the things, which is the ISO and the shutter speed, will be controlled by the camera itself. Or you can shoot fully manual. And in this case, you have to spend time next to your camera, monitoring it and watching it every now and then, especially if you are shooting in a cloudy day or in a day where the exposure will change. Because if you set up the exposure on a specific thing, for example, between night and day, you set up the exposure for the day. And then when it starts to become darker at night, you need to open the exposure more or adjust it to match with the footage, so you will have a day to night smooth footage. For me, usually I go the easy way where I set up the camera on the aperture priority and then leave it to decide the rest by itself. Also, very important thing to consider when you are shooting time lapse is to manually focus on your subject. You have to use manual focus. So you can use autofocus just for the first frame and then switch off the autofocus and continue shooting the time lapse all on manual focus. And that's very important because while the camera is shooting and every time the interval is working between each and every shot, you don't want the camera to start to hand focus and get some shots out of focus, which will ruin your time lapse. So you have to make sure that you shoot always in manual focus. Very important tools that you need when it comes to shooting time-lapse is the intervalometer, which is the timer that it gives you intervals during each and every shot. In my 5D Mark IV, there is internal intervalometer where you can select the time between each and every shot and how many photos you want to take, and the camera itself will take the shots for you. However, if you don't have this in your camera, what you can do is you can buy like this external intervalometer. Those are cheap, they are not expensive. You can connect it to the camera and give the time and the number of shots that you require, and it will automatically trigger the camera. Then you need, of course, the editing software where you take all your images and put them in one container, adjust the exposure, adjust the colors, adjust everything that you like, and then export all the raw footage or raw images to a JPEG and then combine them together in another software where it will create the time-lapse video for you. In my workflow, I use Lightroom when it comes to adjusting the footage itself, the raw files, and then when I export it to JPEG, I import them all to Premiere and then I tweak them from there the way I like. So let me show you how I do my time lapse using Lightroom and Premiere Pro. Usually I use my 5D Mark IV when it comes to shooting images for time lapse because it will give me a good size of raw images where I can edit it in the way that I like when it comes to white balance and the colors and all these things. Similar to when you take a landscape or a portrait photos, that you can control it better when it comes to raw. And this is the first thing you should consider when shooting for time lapse, because RAW will give you always the ability to adjust the footage the way you like. So here we are, I have all the RAW images combined in one folder. So what I do, I selected all and I drag them all to Lightroom first. And after I drag them to Lightroom, I go all the images import. And then automatically Lightroom will import all the images where I can start to work on them. Dealing with raw files on Lightroom this much, like for example, for this shot, it was like approximately a bit before sunset to sunset. And here it takes almost 700 image to do it all. So it takes some time for the Lightroom to deal with it. So what you do, you import them all to Lightroom and wait for it till it happens. And it will all depends on your laptop speed. After I import all my images to Lightroom, I go to develop and I select the first image and I start to tweak it. What I do, fix the profile corrections and the chromatic aberration, and then I tweak the white balance. I adjust it to my taste, exactly about the time when I took the shot. And then I deal with the highlights and shadows the way I see it's suitable for the image. And of course, because I was shooting in a day which was a bit hazy, so I do some dehazing also, and I add some clarity to the shot. I add sharpening as well. In my picture profile in camera, my sharpening is a bit low. And then once I'm satisfied with the general exposure of the image itself, I select all the images and I click on the synchronize, where I synchronize everything with all the tweaks that I did. And you have to wait for it because it will take time to synchronize with all the images. Once the synchronization is finished and all the images is being edited the way I edit the first image, then I go and check the last image, which is very important, especially if you are shooting night to day or day to night, where the exposure will change between the day and the night. Once you finalize your last image and first image and make sure that you edit it the way you like it, you select all the images together and then you export them as a JPEG to a different folder. And from here, we will open the Premiere Pro. I use Premiere Pro usually for my video editing. However, when it comes to time lapse, there are some even free softwares that you can download and use to create the time lapse. It's just what required is to combine all the images together and use it. So when you are in Premiere Pro, you create a project. Let's name it time lapse project 1, and then you save it to any folder that you want, and then you create the sequence. Depends on what you want your footage to be. However, when it comes to time lapse, you have the ability to go for 4K. I take the red 4K and I select 24 frames per second, so it will be 16:9, 24 frames per second, which is 23.976. And I click OK. So now I have the sequence here. Grabbing the JPEG files to Premiere Pro, it's a very easy thing to do. All what you need is to go File, Import, select all your JPEG files. Very important to tick the image sequence. You see this image sequence? Once you tick it, automatically the Premiere Pro will import all the JPEGs as a sequence. You have to keep in mind that if your camera didn't give you a sequence to the images itself, you can do it when you export from Lightroom to give the images a specific sequence starting from one, for example, and automatically the Premiere Pro will import all the sequence. As you can see, this video is 11 seconds, combining all the photos that I took, the way I tweak it already. And then you can put it on your timeline, keep existing settings. And as you can see here, it's a bit bigger than the 4K itself. So what we can do is just to adjust it a little bit to match with the 4K framing. And you frame it the way you like. And then it will be ready in your timeline for editing if you want to add other stuff. Of course, we need to render to make sure that it will run smooth since it's 4K. As you can see, once it's rendered, it will be easier to play, and you can keep the speed the way you like, or you can also reduce it. Now, very important thing here, if you notice, I feel like there are some flicker in the footage, but that's because of I'm shooting on AV, as I mentioned, and there are many ways to get rid of this flickering. There are some plugins that you can use, but for me, since I'm not doing that much of time lapse when it comes to day to night, lots of exposure changing, there is a small trick that I use usually, which it will work to reduce the flicker. And what I do usually, to take another layer of my footage, copy it on top, and by pressing Alt, since I'm using Windows, I shifted one frame exactly. On this specific footage, I go and I adjust the opacity and I make it 50%. Then again, I play the video and check the flicker. If it's still there, and I look at, there is still little flickering effect is there. So what I will do, again, I will take the upper footage and again duplicate it one more time and shift it to the right one frame. Again, fix the opacity and make it 50%, which is already there because I duplicated it from the second. And again, render my footage and check the results one more time. You can do this trick 2-3 times till it reduces the flicker or till it reaches to a point that it's acceptable. However, it's easier if you're using the plugins. There are 2-3 plugins that you can either install it on your editing software or use it before you export the footage from Lightroom. But for me, because I'm not shooting that much of time lapse when it comes to day to night, as I mentioned before, that's why I feel this method will work for me and it will give me acceptable footage that I can use. So now I need to check my footage after I copied it 2 times on 50%, and you can see the flickering is reducing very, very much compared to the original footage. Let me show you again. If we disable this too and keep just the original footage, you can see how is the flickering here in this area, in the sky, it's all flickery. However, if I just duplicate the footage and reduce the opacity to 50%, here you can see the difference, how much it reduced, almost to none. That's very good when you're shooting time lapse. However, if you notice, doing this in a moving subject, you will get the ghosting effects on the subjects. So you have to be careful how many times you use it and when to use it. Of course, you cannot use like this for a commercial work, But if it's for a private use, you can definitely use this footage. After I finish all the editings on the footage, I will nest it together. And then here, something nice also you can add is the zoom in effect or zoom out, which is the camera movement that will give the footage a nice, like, smooth effect, beautiful effect that you need. So after I nested my footage, I come here and on the position and scale and drop a keyframe and then drag them to the side. For example, here. And then here I zoom in a little bit, because that will look nice. And if I want also to control the movement, or left to right, I can do that as well. And then I select them all and I click on ease out, and of course render the sequence to get the effect done on everything. Once it finished rendering, you can play and see how it adds some dramatic effect, let me call it, to the footage. Now, the other thing you can do in Premiere Pro is to add music to your file based on the scene, and then of course export it as a 4K, where you will get the maximum beauty out of the footage, similar to the one I will show it to you right now. So that's it from my side today. I hope you enjoyed this video and it was helpful for you. If you like this video, please hit the like button. I would like also to hear your comments on this video. Consider subscribing and always remember, let your camera tell your moments. Thank you very much for watching and see you next time.